This morning, we'd like you to turn with us to the 11th chapter of the book of Genesis, beginning with verse 1. Here we read, "Now the whole earth had one language and one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. Then they said to one another, 'Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly.' And they had brick for stone, and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said, 'Come, let us build ourselves a city and the tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth.' But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. And the Lord said, 'Indeed, the people are one, and they all have one language, and this is what they begin to do. Now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech.' And the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all of the earth, and they ceased building the city. Therefore, its name is called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth." Book of Genesis, the word Genesis means beginning, and so it is the book of beginnings. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the universe, so you find the beginning of the universe. God said, "Let us make man," you find the beginning of man. We find the beginning of sin. We find the beginning of God's redemption. And now we come to the beginning of religions. The word Babylon has become synonymous for false religious systems. As the Lord addresses in the book of Revelation the false religious systems at the end of this age, he refers to them with the term of Babylon. The word has become synonymous with false religious systems. The beginning is right here. It was the beginning of the false religious systems as they had journeyed from the place on Ararat where the ark had rested, and some of them came into the plain of Shinar. They decided there to build a civilization. And then to make a tower whose top would reach to the heavens. A tower by which they might touch God. One of the typical Babylonian ziggurats, which were places of worship, the study of the stars, and their endeavor to touch God. And thus the beginning of the false religious systems. All of the false religions of the world follow a similar pattern. They start with the earth base, and then they attempt from there to reach heaven. There is within man a questing after God. It's reflected in his religious systems. That desire to somehow reach out and to touch God. There is built into every man's nature the innate need for God. As the psalmist expressed it in our text, in our reading this morning, as the heart pants after the water brook, so pants my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirst for God, for the living God. The psalmist was expressing that universal thirst in man for God. Paul tells us that when God created man incomplete. He made man subject unto emptiness, and that by the design of him who created him. God placed this emptiness within in order that our soul might thirst after God. That was part of the plan of God in bringing us to himself, to make within us this vacuum. And nature always abhors a vacuum and seeks to fill it. And so man seeks to fill this inner vacuum that he has, that desire to touch God. And so man, in his desire to fill that vacuum, created all kinds of religious systems. You see, in man, there is a balance. Nature is balanced. God made it so. There are certain necessary balances in our human body. Within the blood, there has to be so much oxygen. And so we have that monitoring device to keep the body homeostasis, to keep the oxygen level sufficient to feed the blood cells. There is a necessity for a certain amount of moisture. So we have the homeostasis that keeps the moisture balanced within man's body. There is a need within man to touch God, and if man is not in touch with God, his life is out of balance. And there is that endeavor, there is that thirst in man for a meaningful relationship to touch God. Men are constantly trying to fill that need in their lives, and this explains why man in every culture universally is religious. You are a religious person today. You say, I'm not, I'm an atheist. Well, that's a religion. I'm a communist. That's a religion. I'm an evolutionist. That's a religion. You see, a religion is a system of belief that requires faith and demands devotion of its adherents. Communism is a system of beliefs that demands utter faith and devotion. And it requires commitment by the adherents. Would to God that we as Christians were half as committed to Jesus Christ as the communists are to Lenin and to Marx. Evolution, a system of belief that demands faith. That's why I couldn't be an evolutionist. I didn't have that much faith. It requires incredulous faith. And it demands devotion by its adherents. It's only a system of beliefs. They try to pass themselves off as science. But they are dealing only with hypotheses which are totally unproven and unprovable in many cases and often extremely contrary to pure logic. It doesn't make sense to me that this extremely complex organism I call my human body could have resulted over a long series of fortuitous concurrences of accidental circumstances. I can't buy that. So, man is religious. Even though he might try to deny that fact, he is. Universally, the most primitive culture, we see man's religions, the endeavor to find the answer, to solve the riddle, to somehow touch the key to the universe. It all began back in Babylon. As these men set about to build a tower whose top would be in the heavens in order that they might reach out and touch God. Man has to believe in something. And I'm always amazed when a person rejects the truth, what a prey he becomes to every weird and foolish thing. As the Bible said, professing themselves to be wise, they actually became fools. I always get a sense of hurt, sympathy, sort of heartbreak, when I see these poor kids with their white robes, their shaved heads, except for a lock down the back, dancing in front of the bank building in Honolulu with their finger symbols in the evening. I think those poor kids, they think that they're touching God, and they think that to touch God, they've got to shave their heads. To touch God, they have to go into these chants and dances. To touch God, they've got to wear these white robes. And that somehow this will bring them in touch with God. I feel sadness when I see these children on the corners with their flowers, with their little pail and their flowers. And I see them standing there in the evening hours. After it's dark, the little boy is still standing there on the corner near my house. And in the wintertime, he's there. And you see him sort of shivering in his jacket, and he's holding out his flowers in the darkness to the cars that are going by, thinking that as he provides funds for Reverend Moon, that he is somehow coming into touch with God. Back this week in Nashville, when we came out of the restaurant about 10:30 in the evening, here was this poor little girl sitting there on the curb, a bucket of flowers and a little light, and she was holding the flowers up, trying to sell them 10:30 at night. A Moonie trying to earn her way into heaven, or earn her way that she might be able to somehow touch God by selling flowers or selling peanuts in a parking lot or becoming a merchandiser. I see people wearing robes, funny hats, thinking that that makes them closer to God. Through these, they might be able to touch God. So many religious systems, all of them an endeavor to somehow touch God. But we read here that the effort to build the tower ended in failure. They never made it. But starting with an earth base, you can never touch God. Even the existential philosopher of today said, hey, you've got to take that final leap of faith and hope that when you land, there is something there. But we can't assure you there will be. But you can't stay in the realm of despair. You've got to leap out into the upper story of unreality and hope that you can have some kind of an unreasoned religious experience. The leap of faith. Because man needs to touch God. It's innate within him. Not only did it end in failure, it also ended in confusion. And that is always, again, the result of man's religious systems. They always end in confusion. So Babel, which literally means the gate of heaven, has come to mean confusion. And it is a word today synonymous with confusion. Though originally the word meant gate to heaven. The religions, what are they promising? We're a gate to heaven. But in reality, you end in confusion. Why? Because there are so many gates. There are so many religions. There are so many people standing at the gate and saying, hey, this is the way. This is the only way. Everybody else is wrong. We only have the truth. And everyone is there and everyone's proclaiming that his way is the right way. And as a poor pilgrim, I stand and I listen to them and I watch them and I don't know which gate to enter, which religion to follow. And I become confused because all of them are making claims. Look at the confusion today. Even within the religions themselves. Look at the confusion between the Shiites and the Sunnis and the Druze. You say, oh, well, come on now. Look at the confusion within the church. Look at all of the different churches and all of the confused doctrines of the churches. Wait a minute. I will grant you that point. There is a lot of confusion with the churches today, within Christianity. Tragedy that these confusions exist because they don't need to. But there is, and I will confess that, confess it with sorrow. But the reason why the confusion exists in the church is because man has sought to make a religion out of Christianity. God never intended Christianity to be a religion. And as man has made a religion out of it, he has brought confusion because religion always leads to confusion. The beginning of religion ended in confusion. Today, it is still true. Religion will leave you confused. But true Christianity is not a religion. It bears some similarities to a religion. That is, it is a system of belief that demands faith to receive. But that's where the similarity ends. Whereas religions start with an earth base in the endeavor to build the tower to touch heaven, Christianity starts with a divine base, not a tower to reach heaven. It is a bridge to reach the earth. Whereas religion has man attempting to reach God, Christianity has God attempting to reach man. Religion is a picture of man attempting to build a tower to heaven. It is always that way. It is man reaching out to God. There used to be a TV program, one of these, I think it was Miss Mary or one of those gals who had her little classroom with school kids when my kids were little growing up, and they'd watch her on television, and the Doobies and the and the whole thing, but she had her exercise time. And all the little children, she'd sing this song, bend and stretch, reach for the stars. Here comes Jupiter, here comes Mars, you know. And the little kids are out there stretching and higher, higher, you know, touch the ceiling, you know. And these little kids on their tiptoes stretching to touch the ceiling. I never saw one of them touch the ceiling. They tried. They were on their tiptoes, and their hands were extended and their fingers as far as they could, trying to touch the ceiling. But as long as they stood on the floor, they could never reach it. And I saw in that a classic picture of man standing on the tiptoes on the planet Earth, trying to reach up and somehow touch heaven, touch God. And no matter how hard he tries, how tall he stretches himself out, you're still short. You can't reach God. Religion will never bring you into touch with God. The infinite God is just too far from finite man. However, in Christianity, you have exactly the reverse, the opposite. You have the infinite God now reaching down to touch the finite man. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Christianity has its base in God, not in man. For God so loved the world that he reached out and sent his only begotten Son. God reaching down to you, reaching out to you. That's the story of Christianity. Religion is the story of man reaching out to God. Now, where I can see that religion must fail, I can see where Christianity can succeed. I have no problem understanding that an infinite God could touch a finite man. After all, he's infinite. Where I can see why the finite man could never touch the infinite God. And so I see why Christianity can succeed where every religion has failed. Next, in a contrast between Christianity and religion, we find them saying, let us make bricks, heat them thoroughly. Let us build a tower. All of your religions are predicated upon the work of man. It's man's work. And they emphasize those works that you must do in order to touch God. True Christianity does not put a trowel in man's hands and say, now you work and build your tower. Christianity said, there's no work that you can do that could ever bring you into touch with God. You must simply believe the work that God has done. The only way you can touch God is not by your good efforts, not by your being good or following a system of works. The only way you can touch God is by believing that work that he did when he sent his son to die for your sins, to bring you in touch with him. Now, here is where, through the church, Christianity has been made a religion. When the church began to establish certain works that a man must do in order to touch God, it then became a religion and confusion came in. When the church began to say, in order to touch God, you must go into this little booth and confess your sins. When the church said, in order to touch God, you must wear a certain type of clothing. You must fix your hair a certain way. In order to touch God, you have to wear a certain kind of underwear. The moment the church began to say these things, they changed Christianity to a religion. They now were trusting in the works of man. And man being faithful to these works in order to touch God. Now it is interesting that the Bible recognizes that Christianity would be perverted into a religion. And though the Bible warns against this, yet we have seen that it has happened. But the Lord addresses that whole issue in the book of Revelation as the Lord is dealing with that false religious system that he calls Babylon, the mother of harlots. It's the place where the whole religious false religious system sprang out of Babylon. And the Lord addresses it and he said, come out of her, my people. Don't be polluted with her deeds. And God cries to come out of the confusion of Babylon and religion and come back to just the simplicity of trusting in the work of Jesus Christ. There's no work that you can do to bring you in touch with God. There's no way you can be good enough. There's no string of beads long enough. The only thing that can bring you into touch with God is the bowing of your head and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And you have to come on the basis of the work that God has done rather than on any work that you can do. The vital basic difference between Christianity and religion is summed up in one word. It is a word you will not find in any religious system. It is a word that is exclusive to Christianity. And that word is grace. All of the religions are works. They involve the works, the prescribed programs and works. Whereas Christianity is God's grace, his unmerited favor, your ability to touch him, though you don't deserve it. But just because of what God has done, his work for you in Christ Jesus has made God available, and you can touch God. and that void in your life can be filled. And you can experience the richness and the fullness of a life in touch with God, but not by any work that you can do, not by following any prescribed course of man, only by following the prescribed course of God, and that's simply to cast yourself upon His grace and believe that God has done that work for you through His Son, Jesus Christ. Not of works of righteousness that we have done, but by His grace are we saved. By grace are you saved through faith, and that isn't even of yourself, it's a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. So the moment you enter into the realms of works, you enter into the realm of religion, and thus you enter into failure and confusion. The moment you recognize, hey, I can't do it, I can't live by those rules, I can't follow that route, and you say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, then you enter into Christianity, and now you're trusting in God and in the work of Jesus Christ rather than trusting in your own self or works of your flesh. But I'd like to deserve it. You know, I like for God to say, now, Chuck, just go get the 7 golden apples that are protected by that multi-headed dragon. And I'll get my sword and head out to find the dragon and cut his heads off and take the apples and bring them back so that God can say, good job, Chuck, now, you know, I'll touch you. Doesn't work that way. God touches me because He loves me. Not because I deserve to be touched of God, but I just believe Him to do for me what I couldn't do for myself. I trust in His grace. I believe in His work. And as the result, my life is touched, and as the result of that touch, I'm changed. My life is different. My life is full and rich and complete. No confusion. No confusion. It's done. It was done by Jesus Christ. And it is now offered to me freely through the grace of God. And the moment you move outside of grace and begin to put it in your ballpark, then you've moved from Christianity to a religion. And beware. You'll end up confused. Paul said, don't let anybody remove you from the simplicity that is in Christ Jesus. Don't move from that place of simplicity. I trust God's work and the grace of God for my salvation today. God's touched me. You say, well, then you better do... No, no, wait a minute. That's religion then. If I would say to you today, all of you that want to be saved, just lift your hand. Come forward. Go back to the prayer room. And you can be saved. That's religion. You want to be saved? Just open up your heart to God and say, oh, Lord, please help me. Have mercy. Simple. It's just within your heart saying, God, I'm going to trust in you. I'm going to trust in your work. I'm going to just commit my life to you. That's where it is. And just that simply, God will reach out and touch you, and your life will be transformed. Whole new life. Confusion, it all began when man tried to build a tower to reach heaven. And as long as you're trying to build a tower, you're going to stay in that confused state. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you today that you reached out to touch us. that you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son. And that through his work of redemption in our behalf, you have touched us. We have touched you. Oh God, help us now to realize how important it is to not be moved from the place of grace into the place of works, but to stand fast in that grace of God wherein we stand. In Jesus' name, amen. Religion depends on you. Christianity depends on God. I hope you've got the picture. And as you go, if you don't, I hope that you will. That the Spirit will just keep sort of probing and will open up turn on the light and you say, all right, I see it, you know. I see why Christianity isn't a religion. Because I'm not trying to build the tower to God. I'm just trusting in that bridge that God built to me. May the Lord be with you and bless you. And may God touch your life in a very special way as you discover his love and his grace for you in Christ Jesus. May you come into a new relationship with him, a new fellowship, into the very purpose of your existence as God begins to minister to you through his love in many special ways this week. May the Lord strengthen you, guide you, bless you, and keep you in Jesus' name.